planning board on runaway farms. A letter from Frederick Erlenbach to Ernest McVane, dated March 3rd, from regarding the Pond Cove Center. A memo from Ernest McVane to Planning Board Chairman, dated March 4th, 1988, on roadside stands. A note from Mary Alice Pillsbury Riley, dated December 16th, 1987, to Planning Board Chairman. A letter from Mr. Leahy to Chairman of the Planning Board and the Chairman of the Zoning Board of Appeals on transfer development rights, dated February 23rd. We also have a letter from Mr. Clifford to Planning Board Chairman in regard to the Finn Sprague's project. And a letter from Nat Clifford to the Planning Board Chairman about the runaway farms intent of donating land, 19 acres. Is there any other correspondence? If not, our first item of business is the public hearing for Phineas S. Sprague's application for zoning text change to an RA zone. And this is a public hearing. I would remind the public that it would be very helpful if you could come forward and state your name and address clearly and speak up into the microphone. We are taking minutes, and we need to know who you are and where you're from. I guess that we have a representative of Mr. Sprague here, and I will open the public hearing formally and ask if the presentation could be made.
Thank you very much, Chairperson Rand. I'm Peter Murray, and I'm here representing Phineas Sprague, who is asking that the board consider the text change in the residential agricultural district to permit, as an incident to an agricultural activity or in connection with agricultural activity, a boathouse operation for the building and repairing of boats on a very limited scale. What I'd like to propose is that I might outline for you our presentation and why we would commend this change to the board. Mr. Sprague would like just a moment to perhaps give you an idea of how it was that he got started in the building and repairing of fine wooden boats on the Ram Island farm. And I know that there are members of the public who will want to comment on this. And perhaps at the conclusion, if I could have an opportunity to once again speak with you about the technical aspect of the proposed change and perhaps answer any questions that might come up.
Fine.
That satisfactory? The proposed change, which I guess you have all had before you in a package, is the way that we have proposed it is to make a small change in the residential agricultural zone to permit the conduct of a boathouse in which boats are built and or repaired on any lot used in part for agricultural purposes. You recall that the RA zone has a blanket permission for any agricultural use period. And we earlier argued unsuccessfully that agriculture in Cape Elizabeth has traditionally included marine-related activities of the saltwater farm. That wasn't accepted by the Board of Appeals. So what we're asking this board to do is to amend the agricultural zone to make explicit the opportunity to carry on what we think is historically well-established in Cape Elizabeth as a farming community. We aren't asking for a marina-type operation. We aren't asking for a boatyard-type operation. What we're asking for is an operation on the scale that has traditionally been carried out in farms that are located on the sea. And we all know Cape Elizabeth has ancient history as a farming, saltwater farming community. And we, in the packets that have been provided for you, we've tried to show you that that farming activity has included not only the raising of crops, not only the tending of livestock, but the building and repairing of boats to be used in fishing, and later on as the industry has, vacation industry has had a bigger role in Maine, not only have the farmside stands grown up to sell crops to the tourists, but also that on the farms there has been care taken of the boats, the yachts, the private yachts that are used by the tourists, on a very small scale. And so our proposal is that the agricultural zone permit a boathouse operation, not a large yard operation, not a service marina operation, nothing where the public would come or go, but merely a place where craftspeople could work on boats one or two at a time, as people have done in Cape Elizabeth ever since the 1600s, when the first boat built in Maine was built on Richmond Island. And our draft of the ordinance is designed to do that. We don't have any pride in authorship, and we obviously, whatever this board decides is the best formulation from the standpoint of the needs of the town is most important, but I'd like to explain where the direction from which we're coming as we approach this in terms of finding something which is in harmony with the town of Cape Elizabeth and does not create any jarring element in any kind of an agricultural or residential zone. So that's why we have provided in the draft that the boathouse would employ no more than 6 employees, and that the boathouse, if it had any commercial aspect to it, that is, if it was a boathouse for the care of any boat other than the owner's boat of the property, that it would be on a relatively large lot. We suggested 100,000 square feet. I understand that the board, perhaps, or the planning department might think that 100,000 is a little small. We picked 100,000 as a parallel to the other farm restriction, which is that no livestock shall be kept for commercial purposes on a lot less than 100,000, and we figured no boats should be tended for less commercial purposes on a lot less than 100,000. But if boats are deemed to be more serious intrusions than livestock, then perhaps a larger lot would be warranted. But that's the direction from which we've approached this. We think that you've all had an opportunity to see exactly what kind of activity has been undertaken by Mr. Sprague. In a moment, he is going to, in a very few words, tell you how this activity became started from the time he was a youth and lived on Ram Island Farm, or spent a lot of time on Ram Island Farm, which is kind of a large and unique property anyway, as it gradually became this very interesting and unique craft activity that is going on now. I think that as one drives through Cape Elizabeth and looks at the various activities that are carried on, one cannot help but be struck by several things. One is, in all parts of the town, there are, although the zones are residential, particularly in the older parts of town, there is a good sprinkling of home occupation, there's a good sprinkling of small workshops, there's a good sprinkling of persons carrying on their trade and occupation out of their homes, whether it be as a lobster boat and a pile of lobster traps in the yard, or whether it be a contractor's truck drawn up in front of it, or something like that. The Ram Island Farm certainly has a history of such kinds of occupations, and this particular place where the boats are being built, or boats have been being built, has gone through a metamorphosis of activities that have been associated with the farming on the property. Ironic contrast, we suggest, is the fact that just before Mr. Finn Sprague started building or repairing these beautiful wooden boats, the property in question was a large and busy and noxious repair garage for potato trucks and other heavy items of agri-industrial machinery. And that was a perfectly permissible farm occupation, which, whereas the much less intrusive, much more traditional boat building use is arguably not. So we think that this kind of a use in the agricultural zone, with the safeguards that the board sees fit to require, is not going to cause any possible ripple in the atmosphere of the town. Indeed, it would be a much more positive element to permit in the town of Cape Elizabeth, which certainly has already a large portion of purely residential, purely subdivision type of atmosphere, somewhat of the traditional, somewhat of the old nostalgia that can be maintained, and give an opportunity for people who live in Cape Elizabeth to undertake the preservation of crafts which otherwise would be driven out of this kind of area. I think when we're out there, we realize, looking at that shop, that Ram Island Farm is almost unique in the fact that the particular arrangement of Ram Island Farm, which permits Mr. Sprague to have his boat shop there without the usual burdens of commercial or any kind of property, is perhaps the only thing that permits the thing to continue on, because boat building is not the kind of commercial activity which sustains itself very well. It's a craft. It's almost borders on a hobby. And even though it may be commercial in the sense that it is working on someone else's boat, nobody's going to make $1 million building boats one at a time or two at a time in a barn in Cape Elizabeth. So we don't have any risk of a serious commercial intrusion. With those points in mind, I'd like to ask Mr. Sprague, unless there are any comments or questions of a preliminary nature from the board, if Mr. Sprague could perhaps in a few words give you how he got started with this. Are there any questions anyone has at this point?
Fine, let's proceed.
Thank you. Mr. Sprague?
Thank you. My name is Finn Sprague, Jr., and I live on Charles Jordan Road on Ram Island Farm. My great-grandfather purchased the properties that now make up Ram Island Farm around the turn of the century. And the first thing that I personally remember of Ram Island Farm was being very allergic to all of the farm animals. And as a consequence, my first boat was a boat that was built by one of the managers of the farm. And I spent most of my time about a quarter of a mile offshore. I have all my life had at least 50% of my activities being water-oriented. When I finished college, I purchased a 72-foot schooner. I outfitted the boat, rebuilt it, and sailed it around the world for 4 years. And I came back to Portland, to Ram Island Farm, and have been living here since 1977. I have been working on boats on Ram Island Farm, my own boats and boats that belong to other people, for from on and off continuously when I was here. In 1981, I undertook to help the Protestant Yacht Club while I was getting my master's degree, business administration, and people kept asking me to work on their boats. And I started in my basement and out behind the house working on boats. A friend of mine sank a boat in Long Island Sound and didn't know what to do with it. And in 1983, when Mr. Wainwright left the farm, I told him he could put it in the barn. And I helped him rebuild it that winter. It was a friendship sloop called the Dottie G, which is one of the most famous of the friendship sloops. In the time that has passed, I've been working with various organizations like the Schooner Bowden Association, helping to restore that boat. My interests are old wooden boats and restoration and historical preservation of wooden boats. And I found that there were people who wanted to see these boats not lost and restored. So when I recently, I guess 2 years ago, I heard a gentleman whose boat I had worked on asked me if I wouldn't undertake to restore a boat that he'd bought in Ohio, which is an Eldridge McGinnis Eastern class schooner. And I told him that I would do so. And at that time, I also moved that into the barn then. And I've had suddenly realized in the middle of it that if I was ever going to finish this job, I was going to need some help. So with a large number of man hours required to get this boat done in a reasonable amount of time, I undertook to find some good people to help me out. So I have built up a group of really excellent boat builders and craftsmen, and we had approximately two-thirds of the boat completed when we found that we were in violation of the zoning ordinance. I had never myself contemplated that it would be not legal for four guys to get together in the middle of the state of Maine to restore a wooden boat in a saltwater farm barn. But this is how I have arrived here. The intention of the barn has been to preserve the essence of the open spaces of a saltwater farm, and I didn't feel that I was doing anything that was inappropriate. So that's how we get here.
Thank you, Mr. Spray. Did you have some other people, Mr. Murray, that you wanted to speak first before members of the public?
Well, I think they're all members of the public, and so they can speak as their turn comes, and I think you'll know how to heal that.
Are there any members of the public who would like to come forward and speak?
Hi, my name's Chris Bond. I live on Ocean House Road in Cape Elizabeth.
And a former sitter on this side of the fence.
Thank you for remembering that, Madam Chairman. I went back to my comprehensive plan, as many of you had, when I was thinking about this situation. And I read an opening statement that's something to the effect that Cape Elizabeth should be a place where we're proud to live and work, when in fact we all realize that, with the exception of a small handful of professionals, there are very few people that have the opportunity to work in Cape Elizabeth. In fact, if you were to take the economic view and look at Cape Elizabeth as a country, we would have the worst trade deficit in the world. We import just about everything, we export almost nothing. While, in fact, there's a lot of services that are needed by people who live here, it would be paradoxical if all the people in Cape Elizabeth who own boats have to go to Falmouth, to Handy Boat, or to Scarborough, or Saco, or Biddeford to have their boats maintained. My feeling is that there are so few opportunities to work in Cape Elizabeth, it's a real tragedy. And that doesn't mean that I'm for industry coming in where it would create noise, pollution, whatever. I do think that the test is to look back and look at what businesses have historically been allowed to function in Cape Elizabeth and create opportunities for those businesses to continue to operate so that we maintain the true rural nature of Cape Elizabeth. I think that what Mr. Sprague has presented is in keeping with that spirit. It would not create any adverse impact on the community. It would provide needed services for people who live here in the community. It would provide employment, so indeed we could say that Cape Elizabeth is a place where we can live and work with pride. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Madam Chairman, public and rest of the panel, my name is Jack Panzeker, and I'm fortunate to live on Ram Island Farm. As a matter of fact, I live in a house that was probably built by a shipwright. It's one of the oldest houses out there, and if you look at any of the woodwork, you'll see that it was built by a boat builder. And I take great pride in the fact that occasionally I can take my son down to the boatyard, or I could, and watch his craft still practiced. And I think the opportunity for other people in Cape Elizabeth to do so is something that shouldn't be lost. And I don't see any intrusion on the property I live there of any commercial nature, except occasionally to see a boat go down the driveway. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Can I just ask a question,
yes,
Alice?
Certainly. Excuse me.
Yeah. Is there, and maybe this is better directed to Peter or Finn, you talked about the opportunity to the public to see this craft, which sounds intriguing, especially after Mr. Murray's description of it. Is it intended that this is someplace that's accessible by the public, open to the public?
I don't think it's open to the public in the sense of a public institution, but certainly the boat shop has been, if somebody's wanted to come and see what's going on there, whether it be a boat builder interest or even perhaps some people in Cape Elizabeth High School who are conducting, of course, their own boat building course, that arrangements that have been made can be made for them to visit the boat shop. It's just like any ordinary boat shop where people are working. You don't want thousands of people coming and going every day because it is that kind of operation. We aren't suggesting that would be the case, but it is a resource. It's available to people who are interested to go see it or to school groups or otherwise.
I'm Dwinell Griffin, and I also live on Ram Island Farm, and I'm kind of partial to the boat building profession. I originally come off an island. I've been around boats and saltwater all my life. And on this island that I come from, there was three boat yards and three boat building operations going on, especially during the winter months, where about every man on the island worked from one time to another. I started at a very young age. I think my first job was playing in the shavings, and I went from there to pine plugging fastening holes at a penny a hole, and I could make probably the amount up to 25 cents after school each night. And I'm kind of partial to the boat building operation Finney has. I live on the farm. It's a great pleasure for me to know that this occupation and culture is still being carried on. It seems to me that every time new people come into our community, they bring that culture with them. And when they bring that culture with them, we lose a portion of ours. And I think that should be very highly protected when you make your new zoning laws, to keep that in mind, that we're losing our culture and our heritage because of new people coming. The Indians lost theirs to begin with, and every time new people come in this direction, they bring their culture with them, and we lose a portion of ours. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there some others who would like to speak?
Madam Chairman, I'm George Brett, and I'm here representing my wife, who with her brother are perhaps the only two non-spray owners of property on the whole of Random Island Farm. And I guess we are a little bit confused, and we understand what this board is having to face and all, and applying the rules, but we really would like to uphold all that Mr. Sprague is seeking to do, and are standing behind him and everything he's seeking. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, my name is Jim Fisk. I come from Ram Island Farm. I lived there for 13 years. I actually come from Kennebunkport, which has been between Kennebunk and the Kennebunkport area, a large boat building area. I've watched it go on. I've gathered shavings for horses, which I've had. It's something that is very pleasing. It's pleasing to watch. The people that generally do this type of work are nice, easygoing people. I've lived on the farm here now for 13 years. And as far as what Finney Sprague has, you know, been doing, is I'm probably the closest neighbor to where he is. And as far as I'm concerned, I've seen or heard nothing from the farm whatsoever as far as noise or just, it's just a pleasure to take my son down there and see what's going on, and we support it full-hearted. Thank you.
Thank you. Others that might like to speak?
Madam Chairman, I'm Dick Wolf. I am also a neighbor of Finn Sprague. You probably didn't realize you had this many neighbors until this evening. We've been living on the farm for 30 years. We were really essentially in no way bothered by Finn's activities. We think it's an addition to the neighborhood, and we would hope that this board would go along with Finn and his request. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there some others who might like to speak?
Hello, my name is Ted Haffenreffer. I live on Shore Road, but I know the farm probably better than most people, including Finn, because I've been going over there ever since I was born, practically. The use that Finney wants to carry on at the farm in boat building, I think is very important for not only Maine, but Cape Elizabeth. I think it would be a grave mistake if this board did not go along with what Finney wants to do in his boat building operation. And I just like to say that I approve of what he's doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who might like to speak? If not, I might read a letter from someone who wasn't here tonight and would like to have been. And this is from Nathaniel Clifford. He says, "Dear Mrs. Rand, as an abutter to the Sprague Corporation, I support Finn Sprague's efforts to maintain a boat building operation in the existing buildings between Charles Jordan Road and the Spurwink River. Consistent with local open space preservation goals, any land use other than for development should be seriously considered and accommodated, if not detrimental to existing neighborhoods. Building boats is in the reference location has to be preferable and a far more appropriate land use than the 2-acre house lots allowed by ordinance. Sincerely, Matt Clifford." If there are no other public comments at this point, I will close the public hearing, and I would just like to explain that in this process, we are considering a zone text change. The Planning Board has to conduct a public hearing. If they recommend a zone text change, this then would go to the Town Council, where it would have another public hearing, so it will be well heard by its ending. I would like to ask the board to think about the proposal from Mr. Sprague, and I think what we have to consider is not what is perhaps a very fine craft that is being done in the town of Cape Elizabeth currently or wants to be done, and obviously from our site visit we thought that that was an excellent example of boat repair and shipbuilding. But what we have to think about is how does this fit into our overall picture of the town? Do we want to consider a what really seems to me to be a business operation in an RA zone? And if we do, what sort of restrictions do we want to impose on that situation? And I guess I'd like to hear if there are any questions or comments first from other board members. Yes.
Madam Chairman? Yes, I was on that site tour. First of all, your impression, I share your impression of the facility. I was quite impressed with the work being done there, and the general level of craft that was being undertaken was very impressive. So I would generally support the activity of the boat building facility, but, and it's an important but, I think the language that we're proposing for change here sets some precedents. And I think we have to be concerned about precedent in this situation, because as you so rightly pointed out, we are talking about creating a business activity in an RA zone. And while Mr. Sprague's activity certainly fits very nicely, and I have really no problems with it whatsoever, as a planning board member, I've got to think about activity 2, 3, 4, or 5 that may come down the road that may not be as desirable, either for the town or for the abutters near that area. And if we have changed the text in a way that allows this to occur, an undesirable business activity, then we've really done a real injustice for the town. So while I generally support the specific activity that's being talked about tonight, I think we have to be careful in adapting to this change so that we protect in the future business activities that may not be as desirable.
Are there any other questions or comments?
I have a question. Is there a reason why in your proposal you shied away from rezoning this area to one of the business districts as opposed to your approach, which is a business use in a resident in an RA zone?
There are two. One is that we felt that the
Excuse me. Sorry, could you just
Yeah, I think there are two. One is we felt that the text changed to recognize this activity as part of the agricultural business would be do less violence and be more in harmony with the Cape Elizabeth development history and the overall pattern of use than it would be to create a business district in which any business could be run right there out there in the middle of Ram Island Farm. It would seem more appropriate, rather than suggest that this suddenly should be a place where we put it in a business zone where then all kinds of business could go. That's not really what we think is either needed or appropriate here, because what we're trying to do is not a farm is a business. A farm is a commercial activity. People on a farm raise good crops and make money on the farm and have vehicles and have the various kinds of business activities. It's if properly carried on, it's of course big business. So the DARS is just another aspect of that kind of level of business activity, rather than say, well, let's have a business zone where you could have anything from a store to a something open to the public to a machine shop to whatever. And so we felt that it would do less, and there would be no, that we aren't suggesting that would open up the charge to certainly to spot zoning, to have a spotted business right out there in the middle of the farm. And what we're saying is that this is a farm activity carried on one corner of a very large farm.
I just would like to make a comment about the intent of tying this pursuit or endeavor to agriculture. I think I can agree with you that that this is an excellent craft that is being undertaken, and I can see where farmers might repair their own boats or build their own boats, but when you are undertaking the pursuit of repairing other boats or building other boats, then I think you jump into another kind of occupation other than an agricultural occupation, and I know you probably have an answer for that.
Well, I think so, and it may be a matter of degree, that it's almost like the difference between a subsistence farm, where the farmer is only farming for himself and his family to eat the crops and milk the cows and drink the milk, and the farmer who actually farms and sells crops to other people, and maybe one's not a business and the other is. In the case of the traditional saltwater farm, and I think that the gentleman who spoke earlier from the islands had from a similar background, and I think the material that we gave you earlier makes it clear that the farmer did not only build his own boat. In fact, farmers would build boats for others, would fix boats for the tourists, would take care of the tourist boats during the wintertime, would also, one farmer might be a good caulker, another one might be a good sawyer, one would have a sawmill, so that they would cooperate, and one winter one farmer would be building a boat and the other farmer would work on his for money, and then two or three years later it might be the other way around. So it never was quite that cut and dry, just like the farming activity generally is not that cut and dry between subsistence and cash farming. That the other activities that went on the farm, raising livestock, building boats, fishing, had both the aspects of doing for yourself and doing for others for money. And so I don't think it's quite that that cut and dry, just as Finn Sprague's own history. Is part of the time he worked on his own boats, and he worked on his own boats, and other people said to him, gee, you've got a skill there, will you work on our boats too? And that's the way it has been on the farms, that the farmer who turned his hand to boat building in the wintertime would soon be building boats not only for himself, but for other people who needed them.
Any other comments on this thing?
I think what you're hearing is a reluctance on the part of the zoning board, and certainly I have that reluctance, to open up the Residence A, which we worked so hard to create, those of us who were involved in for the last 8 to 10 years in the comprehensive plan revisions, to open that up to a commercial activity. Everything you say makes a lot of sense. On the other hand, I'm uncomfortable with our RA zone hanging out there allowing one kind of commercial venture. I'm not uncomfortable saying that, first of all, if you're going to have a business zone for boat building, it has to be on the water. So I'm not concerned about the spot zoning. If you're going to have it, you have to have it someplace, and you probably have to have it, you know, next to the river on the ocean. I assume you use the water for these boats. Unless you have a fear that somehow it would be an unlawful activity or it would be a zone subject to challenge, I and I think probably the other members of the board would be more happy talking about crafting some words that could allow a business zone, and we could limit it however we want. Do you have some, you've given your reasons, do you have some concern that goes beyond what you've already said?
No, I'd say that I'm sure that there is enough talent on the Board of Appeals to create whatever kind of zone is necessary to permit the activity, whether it be a limited business zone or whatever. When we approach this problem, here we have a craft which is in existence, which certainly the craftsman thought was in harmony with the universe, and then it's found not to be in harmony with the universe, to try and bring it to bring things back in harmony again. But if for policies of the board you would prefer some other formulation, Mr. Butler has formed as a proposed somewhat different formulation in terms of creating a separate use. And so whatever you would want to do. I'd make one comment concerning Mr. Most's concern that the camel's nose in the tent kind of thing, and that we think that in any activity in any zone which is sought to be justified on the basis of tradition or on the basis of harmony, on the basis of the values of Cape Elizabeth, can be evaluated on its own. And so that if someone else came in and said, gee whiz, you people permitted Finn Sprague, that Finn Sprague's request, you now permit somebody to build wooden boats in an RA zone. Now I want to have a tractor repair facility in RA zone. Why shouldn't I have that? I think that it's up to the board to analyze whether the degree of harmony of the proposed activity with the residential use and the agricultural uses, which are the predominant uses in the zone. In this case, we suggest that boat building activity harmonizes extremely well with both residential and agricultural activities. We also think that whereas tractor repair might not, boat building does have a historical connection with the town of Cape Elizabeth in these activities, so you aren't introducing an alien element into the town. And by making that kind of an analysis, does the proposed activity have noxious characteristics that you are seeking to control through the zoning? And again, we suggest that on that test, boat building to this very limited extent does not have those noxious characteristics, so that it would be safe and appropriate for you, if you chose to do so, to make the text so that it can accommodate this activity without necessarily letting the camel's nose under the tent. So the answer to your question is that we would take the zone change in lieu of the text change if that were the board's will, but we don't think that you have to be terribly concerned about the text change.
Mrs. Guthrie.
Madam Chairman, I just had a question about historically, does anyone know how farms were placed in these residential zones, since the farms were here before the residences? And I just wondered why we have never had a special agricultural zone which would allow the farmers, like Mr. Sprague, more flexibility in what they can do on their land. Has there ever been a rural zoning here for farms alone?
Sure, in 1827, there probably was. Madam Chairman, if I might respond a little bit to that and also ask a question. I think farming was so pervasive in the community when it first talked about zoning as a land use control that it was a matter of right and an expected land use, and other things were the things that intruded on the farming, and that's probably one of the reasons that zoning was first adopted in the community. Not to prevent the intrusion of farming into the residences, but quite the other way, to prevent other intrusions into the farming. I think that's proper in a young community's growth as far as land use control. Today we're faced with the opposite issue now of a lot of residences and other things now intruding on those residences as the primary land use. So who knows what happened and what drove things back in the early 60s when zoning, or maybe the late 50s when land use control was first discussed in the community. I don't know if that answers the question, but then I have another addition to that. And I wanted to preface it, Madam Chairman, by saying that all we've heard here tonight is supportive of the operation down there, both by those who live there or within the community and very familiar with Ram Island Farm, and by members of the board who have visited the boat repair building facility at Ram Island Farm. So there seems to be a great sense on the board, and at least those that are here tonight as public, to support this kind of facility being allowed in Cape Elizabeth. What I've heard as a concern are those other types of operations that are as yet unknown, intruding, if you will, on other areas of the Cape in the RA district. Now, we've talked a little bit about floating zones in the past, and I don't presume to bring that up with with presumably it having been discussed at a previous meeting or in meetings with staff or by individual board members. But we've danced around it a little bit tonight, asking why not some special protection device that recognizes the inherent nature of what's being proposed, something that's supported both by the residents in the area and apparently by the board, philosophically at least, and try to deal with the issue first philosophically. Do we support this kind of operation in this particular location? I've had one board member say yes. I think that it's a fine use, properly located in an area that is non-intrusive, and with all of the wording and all of the reasonings for historically based and everything else, and philosophically, I support this kind of operation. Now we're only talking, and if the board agrees, and if then the council agrees, we're only talking about how to implement it, how to protect the rest of the community from things that might be in the future that are unseen that could pose a problem for other residents in the town. And maybe the best way to do that is either through text changes on language that provides enough protection devices for this one use so that it would be acceptable as well if it were duplicated in any other part of the town. I think Steve has done a masterful job of creating some language that that tries to tie this use to an acceptable limit wherever it happened in the town, and that's a proper exercise of text changes. Another approach, and as an alternative, we have the opportunity within our code, and Steve, you might correct me if I'm wrong, because it's been some time since we've really talked about the floating zone concept, that we have a basis that was created many years ago for Business District C, I believe, that allows with site plan review the plucking down of a business C zone after a site plan has been approved for a particular land use if it's appropriate with a number of different criteria for that particular space that the business either occupies or wishes to occupy. So I think we have two bases to go on. If we can jump through the philosophical hurdle, do we support this, then we have to find a way to allow its creation legally in the community and not to be intrusive in other areas.
I think you've outlined the options that we have there quite well.
No solutions, just options.
No solutions, and that's what we're looking for you for, too, for. It's conceivable, too, that perhaps we could use Business District A also, and so I think we have a number of avenues, and it's quite accurate, I think, that this board has to decide, first of all, is this an occupation which you feel is desirable? Can we impose the right restrictions or standards so that this could be implemented? And if so, does it go through a zone text change? First of all, let's hear what the opinion of the board is, perhaps individually, as to whether they feel this is something that would be an attractive occupation to have in the town. I think maybe we ought to start there.
I would definitely support the occupation. I think it really is consistent with the town. I think it's a craft that really fits with the town, and I think the high school program that my own son happens to be a part of is unique, I think, to a lot of high schools throughout the country where there is both graded programs, so it's people are amazed and secure about it. I think in that sense, I'd be pleased, but I'd like to speak to the question of how we implement, and I would be extremely concerned, and I'd like to know a lot more about a situation where we create another business zone of any kind. Once again, my concern is future. Once you create a business zone, it's very difficult to take it away. Now, a business zone, and if in the future a boatyard ceases to exist, or another boatyard that wants to go in, doing something a little different, for example, maybe constructing a plane, they can make all kinds of nightmarish proposals here, you're stuck with it. And I really think that carefully crafted text change is, in this case, a better way to go.
Marin, do you want to speak to either of these points as to the method or
sure.
How you feel?
If I had to make a recommendation to the town council this very moment in time, I would totally reject this proposed amendment because I think that it is just a quick fix to a large problem. And I would strongly suggest that the members of the town council, members of the zoning and planning board, meet not only with Mr. Sprague, but perhaps with his neighbors and other farmers to address this issue with vision. Because I am growing very concerned that our farmers are beginning to think that the town of Cape Elizabeth is discriminating against them in favor of residential zones. So I think that I would like to see a study which looked into the very few farms that we have left and not changed them to business zones, but to give them a little more flexibility. So that's my recommendation.
Marion, you're good at painting the broad picture. I think I'd just like to hear from Mr. Tinsman and Mr. Boxer, and then I will say what I think, too.
I think I said how I feel.
Okay.
And I haven't changed.
And you don't have any preferred method?
I don't think
you are in favor, which I assumed you were.
Yeah, I don't have a preferred method. I'm, as I mentioned, I'm concerned about only protecting for the rest of the community. And as far as creating a zone, we have a provision, I believe, in our ordinance that anticipates that kind of thing happening at some point in the future, where a land use will come along that is appropriately, maybe even ideally, suited for a particular location. And that there are provisions in our ordinance right now that, anticipating that, say to the planning board and to the town council, you'll review that, and if you decide that a zone change is necessary to plop this floating zone down on this particular piece of property, that you can do that. I don't have a favored way. It's whichever is the best way.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Boxer.
I have no objection to the project. I agree with what everybody else said. I don't feel comfortable with business activities. They camel under the tent theory in residential zones. I think that's just going to set us up for being asked to make text changes for other businesses. I would like to see either the approach that Dick is talking about, which I hadn't thought of before tonight, or perhaps simply the creation of another business zone, marine-related, whatever, on the shore, and I feel comfortable having it where Mr. Sprague wants to put his business, and I think we can limit the activities. I like Marion's broad view of things. I'm not sure I think that would take a long time, and I also think with respect to the farmers, we'd have to really, I think you're certainly in line with some of the sentiments that have been echoed recently, but every situation is so different, we'd have to really sit down and spend a lot of time figuring out with the farmers what their future wants and needs are, and I think this particular project would probably wither on the vine and die. So I'd be happy with the creation of a limited business zone on the shore for marine-related activities, tightly constraining what could be done there so that we didn't have a major boatyard want to come in if something happened. I'm comfortable with that approach.
I guess I agree with most of the board members here that this does not seem to be a noxious occupation, that this is something which is desirable to include in the town of Cape Elizabeth. I think Mr. Butler has prepared a text change which speaks to some of the limitations and standards which would protect the town if such a boat repair facility were allowed. So I think that that should be considered carefully. I agree that it's an introduction of a more of a business nature into an RA zone, and that troubles me. I guess what we need to do is to, since we are perhaps of a mind that this is something that we feel is desirable, we have to come to a conclusion as to what method we would prefer to see taken. And does anyone have any comments on that? And Mr. Button, do you want to comment on this?
I think you said it all. Really, I think you have two approaches, a zoning ordinance text change or a zone change. And I think that either one could be implemented rather quickly and allow the use that's being proposed.
We do have our legal counsel here, and he was present for the presentation before the zoning board, and maybe you would like to enlighten us historically or guide us as to whether you feel one method is preferable to another.
Madam Chairman, I would think that if your concern is that it be a commercial use in a residential zone or residential agricultural zone, if there's a majority of the board who is hung up on that, then the alternative is the floating zone, and that is in the ordinance, as Dick says. It's business district C. What's allowed would be business, professional, research, or governmental offices. This is today. Research laboratories and light manufacturing. I suggest that you could easily add for a boat repair facility, and you could then add the performance standards that you have. If you did that, the process would be the site plan would be presented and approved by you, and then to go to the town council. If the council approves it, then that places on whatever size lot has been carved out a business district C. That's a purer way of dealing with it, I suppose, if you're convinced it's a commercial activity that you could run afoul with in a residential zone, not particularly with this property, but with another property with different neighbors, different proximity. So I see three choices. You either amend it along the lines with some changes, if you will, as presented by the applicant, which is change the agricultural use to include boat repair. Mr. Butler has suggested a second alternative, which would be to add a new use in a residential zone. And the third is to, if those don't sit well, the third choice, it seems to me, would be, I don't think it's necessary to have a marine zone. It's certainly a possibility, but I think that may, if the, one of the concerns is dying on the vine, that it would take some time, I suspect, to try to locate and define the uses in the marine zone. But you already have the flexibility of dealing with one site under 1926, the business district C, which would allow you to plop down a zone at that location for a specifically approved use after site plan approval with whatever conditions. And then it goes to this. I mean, I'm just trying to facilitate. I think you have three different ways you can go, and certainly I have no preference.
Let me ask you, if the board should decide that this should go into a floating zone or a business C, still would have to, that recommendation would go to the town council before it came back to the planning board for site plan review. Is that not correct?
Well, unfortunately, I think it does have to take an extra trip, because first you have to change the zone text to say boat repair or however you want to define it. So you change the text, add to business professional and whatever offices, light manufacturing, you add a, unless this would qualify as light manufacturing, a assume it doesn't, assume they want to be more specific, and assume you want to have specific standards in there so that if that is, you know, I'm very concerned that you have standards so that the next one that comes along, you have criteria that you can judge it by. So I would suggest the best way is to have the zone, well, if you're going to go this route, is to have the text changed, which could be recommended by you to the council, and then a site plan approval, and then that.
And then back to the town council again.
For the approval.
Is that not right?
For the approval after site plan approval of this. So they actually place the zone on the map.
Mm-hmm. Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Can I just ask one question? You made a statement about plunking the zone down on previous drive lot. At this time, is that property of 406 acres subdivided further than 406 acres?
The Ram Island Farm, the Sprague property, has received subdivision approval by this board years ago, but never sold off. I don't think anything was done after that, to my knowledge. Okay. As far as the size of this lot, I think it would be up to the applicant, perhaps, to first take the step to find out how much of the property they want to be subject to the zone. I would think it would be a concern to them and their neighbors. I mean, I think that's a threshold question for them to suggest to you how much land at this property should be zoned in this fashion.
Let me ask, if I may, whether you would feel your operation fits under the bill of light manufacturing or any of the other categories listed in the business C.
I'll leave that to you.
Well, I guess, Madam Chairperson, it doesn't matter as much what we think it fits under as what you and your council think it fits under. Light manufacturing. I certainly would feel myself that it is, if you construe light manufacturing as, indeed, it's a very broad term the way it's written in the ordinance, so that I would expect that it could be construed that way to include boat manufacturing and repair, but I guess that we wouldn't want to get in another situation where we construed it one way and the town of Cape Elizabeth construed it another. I'd say if you were comfortable with that, we're comfortable with it. The issue of dying on the vine is a very real one. What has happened, as you know, if we had been able to have this discussion with you from a situation where the town were permitting the activity to continue on a provisional basis while the discussion were taking place, then we could be much more relaxed in terms of the time involved. Unfortunately, the situation is, as far as we're concerned, that the boat shop has been shut down. And that's a kind of a serious problem because the craftsmen who have been assembled are in danger of being dissipated. And so that we've been before boards and boards and boards and trying to accomplish this, but too many more trips is going to mean there's a serious risk that the craftspeople will take a trip, and we may be arguing about a dead corpse.
Yes.
Madam Chairman, if I may, just I'd like to point out to the board that we are having a second meeting a week from tonight, and that the Sprague matter was put on the agenda just in case things weren't resolved tonight. So in terms of the time factor, if people work quickly, we could probably have something ready to be sent out to you before the meeting, and perhaps we could come up with a resolution a week from tonight. So in terms of the time, we might only be talking about a week.
Yeah. Another thought I was wondering was whether it would be possible, and this is up to, again, to, I guess, the town council and the town planner as well as the board, whether we have to do all of these things seriatim. In other words, would it be possible for, if you did decide to go on the sea, for the town, for the planning board to both recommend the language change in the C and also approve a site plan subject to council action at the same time?
You're asking us to do a giant amount in one fell swoop, but it may be conceivable. Perhaps our lawyer can advise us on that more than speak to that.
I guess I'd only mention because of the fact I think the town knows a lot about this particular project already. It's not as if we were coming through.
We have had a very good site visit. We have, I think we are appraised of what's going on, but we do have to take some precautions to make sure we're getting the right ordinance in place before before we move forward. And Mr. Leahy, do you want to comment on whether that would be allowable under one?
Well, I'm not sure you have a site plan presented to you yet anyway. I mean, so perhaps it's more theoretical, because I think they have to decide, if they're going to go under the floating zone, they have to decide what parcel of land do they want, and keeping with all the neighbors who have spoken to. And I think one concern that I would express, volunteer perhaps inappropriately, but I think if you don't limit it to something like boat repair and you have light manufacturing, then you might have another element of the town being very concerned that this is okay today, but what about tomorrow? If this land is rezoned for light manufacturing, you know, you may not have the same sentiment of approval from neighbors and others that you have tonight. I suggest that's one reason why you should have a specific function of boat repair allowed. Secondly, I think you should have the criteria or the performance standards, whatever you want to call them. You don't have a site plan before you. I'm not sure you can have a site plan for approval before you have an allowed use. And I think that's the problem right now. I'd be glad to consider that. We haven't had that before. Part of the problem with the code enforcement office is that so far the ruling of the zoning board is that this is a business use. And as a business use, it's not allowed yet. They can't go ahead and issue permits for fire safety and other things. And it's a catch-22.
How does the board feel about including a boat repair facility under the business floating zone? Let me just get your feeling. Would that be something that would be acceptable to you?
Madam Chairman, if I might, I would support that. And if we are in truly philosophically together as a board and as residents and as an applicant to the town, then I think we can take giant steps. Sometimes when we're philosophically not together or we cannot do something, that things take a lot of time. In terms of the boat repair, I think that's appropriate for the business C. I would like to use the tools that the town has given to the planning board as a strict interpretation of the ordinance. But by the same token, and we are, as a town, strictly interpreting our ordinances, and that's one of the reasons that we have this issue before us right now, I would hope that we don't create a situation where fishermen have building their own boats in their own yard or repairing their own boats in their own yard, which occurs all over the town and historically based, once again, isn't limited, and we as a town don't tell those fishermen from their own properties they have to go to the business District C over in Ram Island Farm. So I think we have to be cognizant of that as well, whatever we do. I would propose that we talk for a few minutes about the business District C, because I think it is an applicable situation. I think that even if the applicant came to us and proposed as a light manufacturing with a site plan at the next meeting, and we approve the site plan, but on the basis of a change in the zoning ordinance to only allow boat repair, that may take care of one of those steps. I mean, what is light manufacturing? It isn't defined. Is that light manufacturing? Perhaps it is. Is the board willing to accept a business District C application in an RA district as light manufacturing? Maybe not, but maybe that's the board's then comment and recommendation to the town council and review process for a particular application. I think boat building is appropriate, and I would hope that we could move towards it. I would hate to see us take 6 months to decide whether this should occur, because I think we've already decided that, and we're trying to find the language now to implement.
Other members' comments on what Dick has said, or yes.
If I could just ask a question of Mr. Leahy, I think I want to clarify why we might be proposing using the Business C district versus the Business A, since the process would be somewhat similar, and I want to find out some of the reasoning behind, and that Business A, in some respects, might be more amenable to this use, whereas Business C is, I think, originally was intended for the more intensive sorts of business uses. So I'm just curious as to why we might want to go to Business C versus Business A.
First of all, Mr. Tinsman suggested it. and it's a tool that's there. And the floating zone, I think, the concept of it is that some uses should be allowed, but we don't know where. And when they're presented, we'll look at them. And that's, I think, what you're being presented with by Mr. Sprague, which is, yes, I suppose on the business A, they're more like a millworking or woodworking shop.
Would the process be the same, Tom, in terms of requesting a zone change for business A in terms of time to Mr. Sprague versus requesting a floating zone be affixed to the face of the earth? Would the process be the same? And if that case, to me, it might make more sense to go with a business A, unless there's an overriding reason to go with business C.
I guess, let me put it this way. I think the main strength or impact of the business C is that it's limited to a specific use at a specific location. And it doesn't cause all the concern that all the other uses in business A would then be allowed at that location. You could have service establishment, retail outlets, what have you. See, my point is that with a business C floating zone, you take the use with site plan approval, and then the council says, okay, and changes the map. I just see it as a more flexible tool, whereas I'm trying to put myself in the shoes of maybe other residents in the area who may say, that's fine. If they want to locate a business C zone for boat building right here, we'll accept that. But if we're going to have a business A zone of umpteen acres with business and professional offices and everything else allowed, we've got some more concerns. And then you have to figure out how you weigh those concerns to allow this use but not the other uses. I see to allow this specific use in that location, that business C gives you the flexibility and prevents it from being expanded and your concerns expanded as to what happens down the street, what happens with somebody else.
If I can just clarify, then you're saying, Tom, that in the business C district could be not taken from its floating state, put on the zoning map, but it would just apply then to perhaps a boat repair facility only, if we want to add that definition. And so that if in the future, if that was the case, then if somebody wanted to propose a business office, that would not be permissible under the new business C district. Am I understanding you correctly?
It's not permissible without coming back for site plan approval and, I think, town council approval, although we've never used that before. I think they'd have to come at least back for site plan approval to change within these allowed uses. But I think that we're looking at this for the first time tonight. I think the intent was to allow a specific use, and they've listed three. If you find that use and you want to plunk it down someplace in the Cape, you can do that, and this is the way to do it. And what I'm saying is if you added a fourth use beyond these three and add some performance standards, as you have already suggested some, I think you resolved a lot of the problems that I hear from Mr. Most and other people, how this is going to impact the next guy who wants to do something else. He has the right to come forward and ask for a business zone in his location, you know.
Thank you, Tom. I would like to get to some resolution so that we can move forward here, and I wonder if we might entertain perhaps the motion of having the lawyer representing Mr. Sprague and our planner meet to consider a zone change and prepare that for the next board meeting, which would be the 22nd, if that would be agreeable to the applicant. And the town attorney.
We really appreciate the positive attitude from members of the board about this issue. We want to do whatever it takes so that this thing can live and so that it's not going to be snuffed out by circumstances. We're real scared about the zone change because floating zones are controversial anyway. Because there are people around who will say, well, if Finn Sprague can get a floating zone for his thing, why can't I get a floating zone for mine? And that Our concern is that we're going to get this poor little boat building shop on the Tramino farm in the vortex of a local brouhaha over the overall issue of floating zoning, which is a pretty controversial issue as a matter of planning anyway. I think that from many standpoints, the floating zone proposal, say like, we like this, let's have it here, sounds like a real good idea. But I think that when you consider the opportunity of the camel and the tent problem, that creating a significant an idea that we're going to take an activity we like and plunk it down here in a zone of its own does provide a kind of a precedent which is a lot looser than the precedent that would be set by a carefully historically founded and carefully limited text change. Now, obviously, we need the relief, so we would take it whatever way it is, but we're really concerned that going the route of the floating zone would cause the debate to be much fiercer and much longer than it would be to take what Mr. Butler has recrafted to make even more limited window of historically based and continuous relief. So I guess what we're up here before, what we really want is we want a text change so we can get in front of the city council, and so the city council can let this opportunity, this business sort of craft shop, boat shop, farm, whatever the little thing this is, to survive before it dies. That's our druthers. We are willing to go along with the language changes. I spoke this afternoon with Mr. Butler about his formulation, indicated only two reservations. One is with the two employees is a little bit too few to be able to build or repair a boat, but we go along with that. But we're really concerned if you say absolutely no text change, we aren't going to consider that. The heck with the boat building in the RA zone. Then the other is that's all there is. And of course we would accept gratefully, but with great concern, that you're using a potentially explosive tool to try to handle a really non-problem.
Peter, let me just comment a minute, because you might not understand part of our concern, and it seems to me that by arguing that we should revert to a historical use in an area subsequently zoned residential, what you're saying is the zoning, let's go back before there was zoning, and if a use existed historically, then we ought to allow it. And I have some real problems with that, because I don't know what kind of can of worms that opens. I think from our standpoint, this town has not experienced, unless there are abutters or neighbors who are concerned about a use, I don't remember any situation where a business use on philosophical grounds has ever been opposed, unless it affects somebody's day-to-day activities. And I think what we've heard here tonight is that isn't going to happen. It seems like the opposite is true. So if that's your major concern, at least historically, you shouldn't worry about it.
Well, we're having a situation of philosophical problems, because that's why we're having this great difficulty here. Nobody has ever opposed this boat shop. Everyone's attitude toward the boat shop has been that they love it, and so that we are in a situation where we're brought into a technical conflict with the regulation. Either one, obviously, any change that would permit this boat shop, if people are concerned about it, and I've argued already that they need not be concerned, because it's so well rooted in both the agricultural activity and the tradition of the town and the lack of noxiousness that it would not create a meaningful precedent. But either one raises the possibility that whatever is done, someone else who had something more noxious would say, look what was done there. And of the two, it seems that floating zoning with a potentially much greater impact of, say, is the one which would potentially raise the greater the greater rhubarb, then it would be a very narrowly drafted text change. But also the issue of time. No matter how fast we operate on the floating zoning, it would take some time that we may not just have.
Madam
Chairman, I'm not sure we're going to resolve this evening because we have two dramatically different approaches, and we have language that before us, while it may be ideally suited for this particular application, would cause every fisherman in town to be shut down by the codes enforcement officer when they tried to repair their own boats on their own land. With the restrictions that are here that are oriented to a very large lot for commercial purposes, but with the setbacks of several hundred feet in all directions, limited hours of operation, et cetera, and a site plan review. Whenever someone wants to take their boat out and repair it or to build a boat on their own site, we're effectively shutting down, once that's enacted, a lot of other operations that have been historically conducted on individual properties. What I suggested was something that tried to move the process along. What we have here, I'm not in support of, as language. I think it's well done for a particular use, but I think it has ramifications that go far beyond the language. And I agree with Marion in what she had indicated earlier. We have a developing problem in this town of not overextending our ordinance provisions to shut down things that have historically happened. And I think that this could be another indication or another example of doing just that. And if you guys, and I missed that meeting, before those fishermen and farmers and felt the heat of a roadside stand, wait till this language is reviewed and analyzed, and each individual application is thought of and how it affects them. I guess we've resolved one thing tonight, and that's philosophically being in support of this operation, and really we're looking for the best means to accomplish that. I would suggest that it may be more appropriate to schedule us for the next meeting, to either change the language so that we don't hurt the fishermen that are existing now and doing their own boat repairs, maybe two or three boats in the yard, and maybe a couple of people working on those, and maybe they work at 7 o'clock in the morning, and maybe they don't have 300-foot setback from all property sides and property lines and everything else. Maybe we need the language that is protection enough, and I really don't care whether it's a textual change or if it's a floating zone. I agree with Mr. Murray that there are some controversies created by floating zones, but it's not an unknown technique. But that either the language is tightened up to prevent the whatever the analogy you guys use about a camel in a tent, or to deal with the hard issue of a floating zone. I would maintain that if the applicant brought in a site plan and asked for it to be reviewed, and if the planning board wanted to review it and approve it and send it to the council, that it doesn't need to be as onerous as everybody going back and forth all the time. But that's something that maybe could be worked out in the next couple of weeks. I don't think it's this language. I don't think we're ready to deal with the issue right now.
Any other members want to comment? I think perhaps we'll have to go back to my original suggestion that perhaps it would be helpful if Mr. Sprague's lawyer, our town lawyer and planner, met to consider whether the route of the text change can be used or whether a floating business zone could be used, and prepare to come to us with recommendations at the next board meeting, which will be on March 22nd, and also perhaps prepare a site plan if we're going to go through the floating business zone.
Is there a right at this point in time to make a motion to table? So moved. Second.
Has been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried, and thank you very much for your presentation. I'd like to just have a 2-minute recess so that we could set up the meeting with Mr. Sprague's representative and... Harry. Our next item of business is Dyer Pond, and we have a wetlands alteration permit coming before us. And Mr. Taylor is here, as he has been constantly for several months previously.
The board has had before it since last August an application for subdivision approval and wetlands alteration as a part of the land off of Shore Road adjacent to our Stonegate project. At the board's meeting on February 16th, 1988, preliminary plan approval was voted for Dyer Pond Road subdivision. At that point in time, the board requested that we not deal at that particular meeting with the wetlands issues, since we had just received a report from the board's wetlands consultant and since there were several other pressing items on the board's agenda. I will point out that there has been a change made in our application for wetlands alteration. And that change arrives from condition E of the preliminary plan approval for Dyer Pond Road, in which it was stated that a condition of approval was that a 2-inch weir be placed at the outlet of so-called pond number 2. In order to conform with that particular condition, we have written the board a letter and suggested that it would be appropriate, rather than building a 2-inch weir, to build a 9-inch high weir that would represent the ultimate development of the project, the ultimate development of the balance of the parcel, based on the limitation to stormwater flow that was discussed and developed as a part of the subdivision approval. That was discussed in our letter to the board of February 26th, which I believe you have available. I think that if there are any questions, I would respond to questions at this point in time.
Once again, you are going to propose using a 9-inch weir, which, as I read the E.C. Jordan letter, that would increase only the peak elevation in Pond 2 to 1 inch. Is that right?
That is correct.
And your reason for putting a 9-inch versus... I'm not quite...
Okay.
Totally.
We had originally proposed, back in August, that there be no weir construction at all as a part of this project. But we supplied information to the board that indicated the construction of a 3-inch high weir would be sufficient to eliminate any increase in peak discharge at Shore Road that would arise from the ultimate development of the entire site that we control. The board felt, as a part of its preliminary approval, that it was appropriate to condition that approval on the construction of a 2-inch high weir. I myself don't know the particular basis for that 2-inch figure. I rather think it came as some sort of sense of partial accomplishment towards the 3-inch figure that was discussed in the August submittal. However, sometime after that August submittal, we got to the point where we talked about limiting peak discharge at Shore Road to 75 CFS as a part of the development of the Dyer Pond Road project.
So what we said is if that 75 CFS is the appropriate value for limitation of discharge at Dyer Pond at Shore Road, then, and we're going to go in there and disturb the wetlands to build the weir, let us build it 9 inches instead of 2 inches so that the disturbance takes place once and that the 75 CFS guideline that was developed through a lot of discussion would be honored in the eventual development of the whole parcel. So that is the reason for our proposing that we go with 9 inches instead of 2 inches, and the existence of the condition is why we felt it was appropriate to modify the wetlands alteration application.
There were several points which, and I'm sure you've read the IEP review, there are several points in there that I wonder if you can address. I don't know whether, I know your wetlands specialist is not here, but on page 5, in the second paragraph towards the end, they speak about, it appears that all wetland areas analyzed were underlain by glacial till. And if this is true, it should be qualified because the geologic settings and surroundings of the wetlands are crucial to all of the benefit values. I would interpret from this that there is a heavy emphasis put on the glacial. Do you see where I'm reading? It's the very last sentence of paragraph 2 on page 5.
I'm not... This one is your consultant rather than mine, and I must confess that I am mystified by exactly what they're saying here.
Is it that the possibility that glacial till perhaps is more readily erodible, or perhaps is a...
Well, in the last sentence, if this is true, it should be qualified because the geologic settings and surrounding wetlands are crucial to all of the benefit values. I'm not sure what that says. I think you do have a recommendation on the record that says the buffer strips are appropriate and as an approach to mitigating impacts of adjacent development. Secondly, all or virtually all the soils in Cape Elizabeth could be called glacial tills. Glacial tills are a combination of clay and bulky mineral soils that have been carried and compacted by the glacier. I think that this is not a special situation. This is ordinary, everyday kind of condition that we deal with here in southern Maine. And I really have to... I don't see what they're attempting to get at here. I do note that they have recommendations beginning on page 11, and what might be appropriate is to discuss the specific recommendations they have made.
Well, there were some in there that I think we do want to talk about. One of them being that in Massachusetts they do require 100 year stone for drainage purposes. It might be that this board would want to consider before final plan review, at least, a study that gives us the 100-year stone data so that we have that, since this is a heavy wetland site.
Well, let me just say that the state of Maine and the town's own ordinance call for 25-year, and we have given that.
You have done exactly what our ordinance states. I'm just suggesting that because of the enormity of the wetlands here, it might be something that would be helpful to the board in judging the overall final plan. But I'd like the board to think about that possibility. That was a suggestion that IEP made in their wetland study.
I'd just like to comment on what Bob just made about most of the people Elizabeth being late again. I'd be careful with that kind of statement. My understanding, which once again is limited, I'm not a soil science plant good, is that glacial till is not an aquifer type of soil. And it was my impression that much of our soil is very capable of water, so our aquifer type of soil. So, I don't know whether you can make the statement that most of our soils are glacial till, but I'd be concerned about that kind of a statement. You may be right, well, but I'd like to have that backed up by somebody who's more technically competent than I am in that area.
Well, I think we could look at the Cumberland County Soil Survey and see what's there. But I accept your caution.
On page 9 of the IEP report, there is a suggestion also about in the last paragraph about putting in oil and grease traps in catch basins with a maintenance plan and including riprap on all the culvert outlets as a protective measure to maintain the water quality. Would you have any problem with doing something like that?
No catch basins are proposed for this project, so I think that that's a moot point. And riprap is a normal treatment at the discharge of you know, where you're going to have water flowing. I think it's also appropriate, as we've heard from Dr. Mishner on prior projects, that that as well as the riprap to deal with reducing the velocities of water, that that grassed areas are appropriate. That the grass has a strong potential to filter out particulate matter, and that most of the pollutants that we're talking about here are borne.
Oil would be picked up by the seeding and grass.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
Any grease or oil or discharge?
Well, what I'm saying is I think we want to go one step further than the recommended riprap. Okay, we want to go to riprap and planted aprons, which is the approach we utilized in Stonegate at the recommendation of Dr. Mishner, because of the ability of the planted aprons to absorb pollutants that are normally carried in highway runoff.
Other board members have questions? Yes, Mrs. Guthrie.
Yes, I would also like to make reference to the IEP report on page 7.
Mm-hmm.
3 paragraphs, sort of in the middle of the third paragraph down. The report states, therefore, the cart road, which is the road you are proposing, the access road, acted as a small flood control structure across the north center of wetland SC007, south of the Shore Road culvert. And this is what I found most important. Additional filling of the wetland here for Little Pond Road will displace flood water and may act to reduce storage of flood water by interrupting the surficial connection to the southern basin of SC007. Do you have any comment to
yes,
make
we,
on that?
The construction plans propose that the connection be maintained by the installation of 4 culverts, which are shown in the construction plans, and an analysis of this particular issue was performed by the E.C. Jordan Company and discussed in their letter, I believe, of October 2 of last year, and concurred in by Hunter Ballou. I think that the IEP people did not have an opportunity to fully examine the record in that area. At least that's the discussion I had with Mr. Titus the evening of the last meeting. I think that in summary, I think the matter, the issue has been addressed, and I believe it is IEP's feeling that it has been addressed also, but I don't want to put words in their mouth.
Any other questions by
board members. Yeah.
Madam Chairman, I just have two. At the last meeting, when we were talking about wetlands, IEP had identified one area that wasn't included that you felt should be.
Mm-hmm.
It may not have a major impact, but I just noticed that we didn't receive any maps with that, and I assumed that would be added on to the final plan.
That is fine, and we have a copy of IEP's mapping of that.
Okay. Has that been placed on?
We have not revised the plan because it was my impression that that's how we were going to handle it, is either a condition or an addition to the final plan.
Another point I have is, or question was, or clarification, is in terms of the pond that's, I forget what the SDF number is, that's about halfway back south of Dyer Pond Road.
Mm-hmm.
It's one which was originally targeted for what I like to call pond enhancement.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure and clarify for the record, I've heard stated verbally that pond enhancement is no longer proposed. I just want to hear you
pond,
say one more.
Pond enhancement has never been proposed. Pond enhancement is discussed in the report. But if you will look at the wetlands application material, do not call for any construction in the pond area.
Okay. Great. Just wanted to clarify that.
Another point of clarification, which although perhaps we don't have to tie to the wetlands alteration permit, it certainly is closely related, and our old friend, the resource protection
mm-hmm.
area. We do have a resource protection area. We do need to address the standards that are outlined in that before we get into an acceptance of any construction of roads going through there. Mr. Tennyson, are you poised to?
I look like I was reaching.
Yes.
Madam Chairman, I would only ask that my question is directed more to Steve Butler. He's prepared a memo and distributed this evening wetland alteration standards and has prepared an analysis, and I'd ask for that analysis.
Okay. In essence, if you feel... Let's go back. Last meeting, we granted preliminary plan approval with a number of conditions, some of which were based upon a further analysis of the wetlands report that was issued by IEP. I've given that a review. I assume most of you have. According to the, I think there's still some issues outstanding that have a bearing on wetlands alteration, and which I expect will be addressed in the final plan review, but for the most part, and for the purposes of the wetlands alteration section in the zoning ordinance, going through the standards, I found that given the conditions and the information that's been provided at this point, that I found that the applicant has met the standards on the wetlands alteration. Not to say that additional standards may not want to be imposed at a future point in time, but at this point in time, there seems to be enough information to indicate that wetlands will be adequately protected. Again, I'd like to point out that Madam Chairman Rand's comments about the Resource Protection District still are out there and will need to be addressed by the applicant before final plan approval. So.
If I may speak to the Resource Protection District, on October 1, 1987, as a part of one of our submittals, there was a two-page discussion of resource protection associated with the proposed road construction, and there are 10 items that are standards in the ordinance, and I would be happy if now is the appropriate time to discuss those performance standards and the way in which we conform to them.
I don't know what the board's pleasure is. I think here tonight we are reviewing the wetlands alteration permit, and if it is your pleasure to get into resource protection, I'm sure we can.
At this point, I just want to make clear that one reason why I haven't said anything is because I believe that a potential conflict exists, so I'm not engaging in a discussion or certainly any vote on this particular matter. I want that to be clear, and secondly, I need to swear somebody else in for that reason.
Oh.
I'm afraid we don't have anybody that we can swear in, unfortunately, at this point, since our new member really isn't effective until April 1, but we do still have a quorum, so we will be able to vote.
I'm sure he's effective every night, but he's just not legal.
I would kind of like to keep us to a wetlands point here, not really stray, because once again, we're into only the second item on our agenda, so... Just in terms of keeping our meeting going.
I would remind the board that also under the wetlands alteration permit, if they feel it is necessary, we may require the applicant to furnish us with a bond. And I don't know whether any thought has been given to that as to the necessity of having a bond or not, and whether the town planner has any comments about that.
Chairman, wouldn't a bond as part of the final plan approval also include any of the wetland alterations that would occur as part of the subdivision?
Yes.
So we would have that anyway?
Yes. I believe so. Is that correct?
Yes. I think may want to make sure that the record reflects that fact.
Are there any other questions about the wetlands or comments?
Madam Chairman, I am still not convinced that there should be an okay written to the left of item 2. Will not impound surface waters or reduce the absorptive capacity of the alteration area so as to cause or increase the flooding of adjacent properties, since this is a flood-prone area to begin with. And so unless we had the figures on the 100-year flood, figures based on the 100-year flood, I certainly couldn't be convinced that that was okay.
Madam Chairman, I have a question to that. And you raised the question very appropriately earlier, and now Marion raises it again. In reading the reports, though, I thought that there have been several instances where it's been indicated by our own engineer and by theirs, the applicant's engineer, that flooding wouldn't be increased, that post-development, pre-development, post-development would actually be less than pre-development, indicating a change, but a change for the better. That hasn't changed in anything, has it, in the last 6 weeks?
That's correct, and I believe that both E.C. Jordan and Bob Hunter have reviewed all this and have come up with lower figures.
To the issue of the 100-year, I wish we could do that, and I think that it's appropriate that we might suggest a zone change or an ordinance change to the town council to allow a 100-year review rather than a 25-year review. I think, though, we're limited to our ordinance, and we really can't step beyond our ordinance on what an applicant has to propose or present to a town. Right now, it's 25 years. I think it's appropriate that we do 100-year, and maybe that's something that we should submit to the town council. I'm not sure we can hold this applicant to that, though.
But according to the IE, it is IEP, or is it EPI?
IEP.
According to that report, they suggested that this entire access be moved out of this area, if you recall. And it is a concern of mine.
And that is a good concern, and I think that IEP in their report said that there would be something like maybe 11,000, over 11,000 square feet if we went further to the north with our access. No, excuse me, it would be 11,000 square feet if we used the southerly access, but it would only be something like 4,000 plus square feet if we used the northern access. It's my own opinion that we have had comments from the traffic engineers and from the police chief and from others that it would be safer to site that access to the south, and I guess I feel strongly that in this situation we have to let safety overrule wetland considerations. And I know we've made that same judgment in a previous development, even with this corporation. So I think I stand by that, but I'd be interested in hearing others' comments on it.
Well, Madam Chairman, you've got a delta of 11,000 to 4,000. You've got a delta of 7,000 square feet of additional wetland filling, which is 2,000 square feet more than a landowner can do on their own property without any permits or anything else. So I support what you're saying. And I guess as one member of the board, and we'll be voting on this one way or the other, that review the materials and our planner is indicating that all standards have been met. I think number two has been met on the basis of ordinance. I think Mr. Spencer was right. It would not probably be met if we were looking at a 100-year standard rather than a 25-year standard. But I don't think we can do that, particularly at this moment. And if all the standards are met, I would think we should be prepared to vote on it this evening.
Any other questions or comments before we consider a motion? We do not yet have, we've not heard anything from the EPA or the Army Corps of Engineers.
You changed the ball game on us last month by talking about the weir. So anything that was involved with our prior discussions with the EPA and the DPA and the Corps of Engineers is now out the window.
Would you explain that a little further?
What do you mean? The subdivision approval required wetlands alteration in excess of anything described in our correspondence with those other regulatory agencies. We described, when we dealt with those other regulatory agencies, we dealt on the basis of the proposal made to the board. The board found it appropriate to approve our proposal with a condition that changed the wetlands impacts for the project. Therefore, any correspondence that we have had with outside regulatory agencies really wouldn't apply because we have a slightly different situation. Our intent is that that we will obtain all necessary permits and approvals in the interim between preliminary plan approval and our application for final plan approval. That is the way that the ordinance contemplates you go.
Are we ready for the motion? Would someone like to entertain reading it?
Madam Chair.
Moving it.
I would move that we order that the request of the Ibis Corporation for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for Dyer Pond Road, a proposed 8-lot subdivision located off Shore Road, be granted according to Section 1939 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. That septic tank, septic systems shall be placed far enough away from wetlands to ensure proper filtering. B, that any conditions attached to preliminary or final subdivision approval shall be applicable to this planning board permit. And C, that no construction or wetland alteration activity shall occur until after final subdivision approval is granted by the planning board.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Opposed? It is carried 3-1. And you have your wetlands alteration permit. Mr. Butler has a word to say.
In respect to resource protection, I did find Mr. Taylor was correct. October 1st, he did submit some documentation, which became buried in the huge pile. It appears from my cursory re-review of this that he's met all the standards. The question would be to the board, because it's very similar to wetlands alteration in terms of the standards. The issue to the question of the board would be, given the fact that you probably would have to dig it out of your files too, do you want to include that, or do you want to entertain a motion to that respect tonight, or would you prefer to wait until final plan approval? I guess I also asked the question of the applicant, what his preference would be.
One more member, once again, it's not something that was on our agenda. We were running late, and I would like for one to see it tabled for later.
With the final application.
Yes. I would prefer to see that also.
Madam Chairman, if I may, the application was made on a timely basis. The information was submitted on a timely basis. The project has received significant discussion, including discussion of the need for construction in a resource protection zone, which requires a planning board permit. It was, you know, requested. We, the applicant, have consistently granted extensions in the time period for consideration as a part of the mutual effort in seeing that the project is fully considered. Quite frankly, it's a shock to me that the subdivision plan approval doesn't, in effect, is not in effect, permission for construction of resource protection district, because that was a part of the basic application, and it is inherent in the plan before you. So I am wondering if either we aren't chasing an unnecessary additional step because of the nature of the application, the nature of the plan, the nature of the information, or alternatively, if the board, from a fairness perspective, could examine this tonight, because if there is a condition or a rejection that's here, it could again change all the applications that are necessary to the other regulatory agencies involved. So I'm quite frankly a little bit confused as to where we are and where we should be. And so I would ask the assistance of the board as to where are we and how can we proceed in an expeditious manner.
Madam Chairman, just to respond, turns out that Mr. Taylor did submit the information with his original packet and with his wetlands alteration information. On the other hand, according to the zoning ordinance under the Resource Protection District standards, a separate planning board permit has to be issued by the board, very similar to the wetlands alteration. And therefore, although the materials were submitted, I hear what Mr. Taylor's saying in terms of wanting to get the request tonight. I guess the one point I'd like to make is that approval of the planning board permit for resource protection alteration, in my mind, did not occur during preliminary plan approval. That leaves open the question what the board wants to do tonight with resource protection.
I guess I would stand by my previous statement that I would like to consider this at another time, but I'd like to hear other board members.
I stand by my expectations. And I listen to hear what Taylor is saying. It sure sounds from what he's saying that there was an oversight or something left out. And I'm wondering if there's not a possible compromise here. I hate to throw things into an agenda next week, it's going to be very low, but...
Sure, you're by your shoulders.
Is it possible for staff to review the situation and brief us sufficiently so that we could handle this at our meeting next week? I mean, a week's
late.
I apologize, but at least we do have an opportunity to do something with it.
Right. From the staff's perspective, I think that would be very easily to be done. I mean, I feel comfortable in actually doing that tonight, but if the board wants that additional time, there'd be absolutely no problem in doing that in time for the next meeting.
What is the board's pleasure? I think I would prefer to see that occur.
I guess I have a question as a member of the board. I would have thought that Resource Protection District would have been discussed during preliminary plan review, and I'm sure it was and considered. And to me, once you give preliminary plan review, that final plan review is really a pro forma review process to make sure that all of the conditions have been met or any additional standards based on the preliminary plan approval which you did. You conditioned the preliminary plan approval. But tonight we talked about wetlands, we talked about the road, we talked about filling. You approved the preliminary plan at the last meeting. Are there really substantive issues for resource protection that still remain before the board? Or is it just another step to go through? I mean, all of those issues have been discussed, presumably.
If I may, it appears to be primarily procedural, in my opinion. But that's my being able to look at the information in front of me.
We have a difference of opinion, I guess. We are arriving at a difference of opinion as to whether to consider it tonight or put
no,
it on.
No, I'm not asking for it to be considered tonight. And I think it's appropriate to do it at the next meeting. Things have to be prepared, your analysis has to be done, and the board has to look at that and approve it. So it should be next meeting. If that's a separate step we have to do.
It sounds like it's something that we could dispose of pretty quickly at the next meeting, too. So that's what I want to do.
Just to put it on the agenda. And since it would be under old business, we perhaps